Hey folks, I'm Hunor, and in this video we learn how to code images. You might be wondering, why would anyone code an image? There are designer tools for that. SVGs have a similar syntax as HTML. And since HTML5, we can include the code of an SVG inside an HTML document. We don't need to use the image tag that refers to a separate SVG file. We can have the code of the image right inside HTML. This opens up a lot of cool options, because SVGs behave like HTML now. Suddenly, we can access parts of an image from JavaScript to make something interactive, or we can generate art with code. Probably, for more complicated images, you will still use a designer tool, but the next time you need something simple, like a hamburger menu, a heart icon, or a YouTube logo, maybe you can code them yourself. In this video, we go through the source code of 24 SVGs, from simple to more complex ones. We start with basic shapes, then we go through curves, and finally we cover some fun examples on how to animate SVGs and how to make them interactive. First of all, we have to talk about the SVG tag itself. This tag contains the image elements and defines the frame of our image. The width and height properties defines how much space the image takes up in the document. There's often a viewBox property as well, which defines the coordinate system for the elements of the image. These two can be confusing, because they both define a size. You can think of the width and height of the SVG as an external size, and the viewBox as an internal size. The size defined by width and height is how the rest of HTML thinks of the image and how it appears in the browser. The size defined by viewBox is how the image elements think of the image when they position themselves inside of it. If the two don't match, then the image simply scales up or scales down. Normally, the coordinate system in which the image items place themselves starts at the top left corner with the 0, 0 coordinate and grows to the right and downwards. With viewBox, we can change this. The first two parameters define which coordinate should be at the top left corner of the image. Then the last two ones define the size. In all the examples through this video, I centered the coordinate system. The 0, 0 coordinate will always be in the middle of the image. Since HTML5, you can have SVG images in an HTML file, but that doesn't mean that you can freely combine any SVG tag with any HTML tag. The SVG tag represents the frame of the image, and every SVG element has to come within an SVG tag. The same is true in the opposite direction. HTML tags can't be within an SVG tag, so you can't have a div or a header tag inside an SVG. But don't worry, there are similar tags available. While SVGs can be defined as standalone files, you should think of the examples in this video as they are embedded in HTML. Some of them wouldn't even work otherwise. When showing the code of an image, I won't always show the framing HTML document, because it wouldn't fit the slides. But imagine them as they were there. Now that we said all that, let's move on with our first example. Let's start with a simple Christmas tree decoration. Here we use simple shapes, a rectangle and two circles. We position and style these elements with attributes. For the circle, we define the center position, and for the rectangle, we define the top left corner. These positions are always related to the coordinate system defined by the viewBox. Remember, we move the center of the coordinate system to the middle of the image, and the x-axis grows to the right, and the y-axis grows towards the bottom. We also have presentational attributes that style our shapes. Unlike in HTML, we do not use the background color to set a color for a shape, but we use the fill attribute. And to set a border for a shape, we use stroke and stroke bit. Note how we use the circle element both to draw a ring and a bowl with different attributes. Let's move on with a Christmas tree. We can't always use basic shapes to assemble our image. A polygon is the simplest way to draw a free-form shape. Here we set a list of points that are connected with straight lines. You might be wondering, how do we know before starting to code where would be our coordinates? To be honest, this requires a bit of imagination. You can start with pen and paper to draw a draft first to get an estimate, or you can just make a guess, then adjust your values till it looks good. This is the reason why probably you will still use a designer tool to draw more complex shapes. Let's move on with the gingerbread figure. Since our SVG is living inside an HTML file now, we can assign CSS classes to each tag and move some of the attributes to CSS. You can only move the presentational attributes though. Position attributes and attributes that define the shape still have to stay in HTML, but colors, stroke, and font attributes can be moved to CSS. We already saw the fill and some of the stroke properties, but here's another one, the stroke line cap. This can make our line cap round. Note that the legs and the arms are simple lines here. To give you a comparison, if we remove the line cap and set a smaller stroke width, then this is how it would look like. But by setting a thick stroke width and a round line cap, we can shape legs and arms for our figure. Also note the Rx property at the rectangle defining the mouth. This will make the edges rounded. You can think of it as border radius if you like. Moving on with the house. What you can note here is that there's actually nothing new here. We just combined the previous elements and added a bit more from everything. I won't cover this in detail, but you can check out the source code on the link below in the description. Let's have another Christmas tree decoration. This one has a motif on its side defined as a polyline. Polylines normally wouldn't care about the edge of the ball. Part of the line would overhang or stop too soon. We use clip path here to make sure that the motif fits perfectly with the ball. We define the motif to be bigger than the ball, then we cut the overhanging parts with clip path. The clip path is defined in the definition section. The def section is like a hidden compartment of our image. Things here don't show up as part of our image, but you can refer to them and use them later. Let's move on with a star. A star is a simple shape, so we could define it as a bunch of polygons and set each point individually. But then we would need to know each coordinate. Instead of that, we can just define one wing, then repeat it 5 times with the rotation to get the same shape. We use the transform attribute to set a rotation. In this example, each wing consists of 2 polygons. They need to be rotated the same way so we can group them with the G tag and rotate them together. You can think of the G tag as the div tag in HTML. On its own, it does not represent anything, but it can contain other elements and attributes defined on the group tag apply to its children. So that's a nice trick, but now we are repeating the same code for each wing 5 times. Instead of repeating the same code over and over again, we can also create a definition for a shape and reuse it. Here we define a branch of a snowflake, then use it 6 times with different rotations. The branch is defined as a path. The path is the most powerful SVG tag. We can define pretty much anything with paths, and if you open an SVG file, you will see paths mostly. The shape of the path is defined with the D attribute. Here we define several commands. A command always starts with a letter, defining the command type, and ends with a coordinate. Here we only have the 2 most simple commands, moveTo and lineTo. The moveTo command moves the cursor to a point without drawing a line, and the lineTo command draws a straight line from the previous point. A command always continues the previous command, so when we draw a line, we only define the endpoint. The starting point will be the previous command's endpoint. This path is a bit unusual because there are several moveTo commands in it to draw the main branch and each side branches with the same path. Rotation is not the only way we can generate images from simple shapes. In this example, we define a tree shape, then place it in various positions in different sizes to draw a forest. Now let's have a quick detour with gradients. The filling of a shape can be defined as a gradient. Here we apply a radial gradient to our Christmas decoration to have a subtle 3D effect. It has a different syntax than CSS, but the capabilities are rather similar. Gradients in SVG though can also be applied for strokes, and pretty cool effects can be achieved that way. The same effect can be used to draw a snowman. Here we have 2 circles to draw the body and the head, that is reusing the same gradient definition. So far, we only had basic shapes and straight lines. Let's move on with curves. The next few examples, we use curves to define a shape. The path element becomes really powerful when we start using curves. One of them is the quadratic Bézier curve that not only defines the endpoint for a segment, but also defines a control point. The control point is an invisible coordinate to which the line is bending to, but not touching it. Here we have a series of quadratic Béziers where the control points get further and further away from the center of the tree as the path goes down. While the quadratic Bézier is great when we want to bend the line, often it's not flexible enough. With cubic Bézier, we not only have one control point, but two. The first control point sets the initial direction of the curve, and the second one defines from which direction should the curve arrive to its endpoint. If these directions match the direction of the line segment before and the line after the curve, then we have a smooth transitioning between the path segments. In this example, the ribbon on the gift box uses a cubic Bézier that smoothly continues the previous straight line, then turns back to the direction of the upcoming line. Let's have another example with cubic and quadratic Béziers. Here the bottom of this bell is defined with straight lines. Then a quadratic Bézier starts the bell cloak, then the line is continued with a cubic Bézier to form the top of the bell, then we reach the bottom part with another quadratic Bézier. Of course, you can always complicate things even further. This example uses a combination of simple shapes and curves to draw a beer face. I'm not getting into the details now, but again, you can find the source code of this and every other example covered in this video on the link below. If you thought that cubic Béziers are the most complicated parts of SVGs, then I have bad news for you. Arcs are even more complicated. The good news is, on the other hand, is that arcs are not used that often. The last two parameters are still the endpoint of the arc. Arcs have 5 extra parameters on top of that though. You define a horizontal and a vertical radius for an arc. If these two values are not the same, then you end up with an ellipse. If you draw an ellipse, you can also turn it by an angle, which will be the third parameter. Given the starting point coming from the previous segment, given the endpoint defined here, and the radiuses, there are still 2 possible arc centers and 4 possible arcs to draw. The last 2 parameters of the arc are to pick one of these 4 options. Here we can see a simple example of using arcs to draw a candy. Drawing shapes are not the only use case for paths. We can also use them to render a text along an invisible path. We can define a path in the definition section to make sure it's invisible. Then we refer to it in the text path attribute to make a text go around the circle. Here we use arc again, but you can use any other path and the text will follow it. Another fine use of paths is to create animation paths. This method is not SVG only. I'm using a CSS property here that works for any other HTML tag. But if you check the value of this attribute, you see that we define a path the same way as we do for SVGs. To give you a fair warning though, this feature at this point is rather experimental, and it's not supported in Safari. There's also an old SVG-specific way for doing the same thing with animation motion. Unfortunately, that's rather obsolete. So at this point, neither of these are fully supported, but I'm sure there's going to be a way in the future to use paths for animation. A more traditional animation that certainly works in every browser is a ringing effect. We animate the transform property with keyframes. We can even trigger this effect on hovering. There's nothing SVG specific here. The same works with any HTML element, but it's a cool example on how to combine SVGs with CSS. To continue our forest example, we can also add the snowing effect with a similar animation. We animate transform again, but this time we move many more elements. It's a bit glitchy and not the most sophisticated animation, but you get the idea. This example is a bit of an Easter egg. For any HTML element, you can set a background image in CSS. Here we usually provide a link to an image, but we can also inline one here. Normally you wouldn't do that, because you end up with something gibberish in your CSS. If you do that with an SVG though, then it's not even that cryptic. This SVG code is still character encoded, so that's why you still see some weird parts. The pointy brackets are replaced here. This is a great way to create background patterns with only a few lines of code in CSS. If you like the idea, check out svgbackgrounds.com for a lot of great patterns. SVG elements can also be manipulated from JavaScript the same way as with any other HTML tag. In this example, we are using a short code snippet to show the actual time on a clock. You can even have a script tag inside the SVG, but of course you can have it outside of an SVG and refer to the elements the same way. There's another trick here worth mentioning. The dots here showing each hour are actually part of a circle. In CSS, we can set the border style to be dashed, but CSS is not too flexible on this one. SVG though took this to the next level, and you can fine-tune the length of each dash segment and the space in between. That's what we are using here to show the dots for each hour. We can not only manipulate SVGs from JavaScript, but we can also assign event listeners to parts of SVG. Here, by clicking the red button, we switch on and off the lights. The possibilities are endless. You can even create a full-featured game with SVG and JavaScript. SVGs also work well with front-end libraries. Here I'm using React to generate a data-driven diagram. Here I'm both generating a list of rectangles to create a column diagram based on some data and also generate a series of coordinates for a polyline. For simple use cases, you can code your own diagram like this. But if you need something more complex, then check out the D-tree library. The D-tree library uses SVG under the hood to create all sorts of diagrams. If you really got into SVGs and you got one where the code got a bit out of hand, then you can break it down into components. Here I'm using React again, but the same things apply for Vue.js. Mind though that there's only one SVG tag at the root component, as there's still only one image. The child components have their content in group elements. Okay, if you got this far, I hope SVGs became a bit less mysterious for you, and you find some fun use cases for your future projects. There are many, many cool things you can do with SVGs, just check out CodePen for inspiration. And if you like this video, please subscribe, I'm planning to do some in the future in a similar fashion. Let me know in the comments below what you would like to hear about next. See you at the next one.